Now, in the next two lectures, we're going to look at preoperative pulmonary assessment. Now, we're talking about patients with known disease. They have either asthma or, more importantly, COPD, or they're at risk of developing postoperative complications. And what we're talking about is pneumonia and respiratory failure. But we really have to shift goals. Now, remember in the first set of lectures where we looked at the cardiac complications, we had a beautiful algorithm. In that algorithm, we had nodes and we made decisions based on that, and then we moved along the algorithm. We don't really have that for pulmonary assessment. There really is a lack of clear-cut research evidence to tell us what to do and how to properly examine these patients beforehand. So what we've really got to do here is to think risk assessment and risk management. So here's a long list of risk factors. Now, not all have been shown conclusively to be independent risk factors. Some of them have, and they've been built into online calculators, and those are actually beautiful, both for pneumonia and respiratory failure, and we'll talk about them in the second part. But here's a list. Age, of course, the older your patient is, the higher incidence of having underlying lung problems, and the worse they are going to do with, say, prolonged anesthetic. So age, definitely. Pre-existing COPD, a patient with COPD is at higher risk of developing complications. Cigarette use, well, that just goes for most complications. Then a patient with CCF, definitely. The functional status, that patient that has exercise intolerance, that can't walk because of oxygen and CO2 exchange, that patient's going to have post-operative problems. A higher ASA class. A prolonged duration of the surgery. Certainly there's going to be a big difference between 5, 6, 7 hour procedure and a quick 20 minute procedure. And then also the type of surgery. Now think about an appendectomy versus a upper abdominal gastric resection, say for gastric cancer. Those two really are going to have different outcomes. Recent weight loss. Think about a patient with muscle mass loss. They're not going to be able to breathe properly postoperatively. They might not have the muscle strength to cough up their secretions postoperatively. Then long-term steroid use, they're going to have the muscle mass problem, but they're also going to have an immune problem. They're not going to be able to fight infection, and we might have postoperative complications. And the same really would go for alcohol use. So a good history and clinical examination. Ask the patient about pre-existing disease. Ask about specific symptoms. Coughing, dyspnea, orthopnea, ask about these things, ask about their medication, ask about smoking, and we'll get to this a bit later. Don't ask, do you smoke? They say, no, I don't, because they just stopped yesterday. That, of course, doesn't count. Be careful, do a thorough examination, and take a thorough history. So here's a little rule of thumb. It's not an algorithm at all, but first of all, as with anything, if the surgery is of an emergency nature and it is life-saving, you've got to go ahead with it. There's no need to waste time with tests. There's really no sense in that. But if a patient has known pulmonary disease and they are not at baseline, in other words, they say, Doc, I've got asthma, but I'm on medication. These are the number of attacks I get. It hasn't changed recently. I'm not coughing more. I haven't developed more dyspnea, say, for instance, for the COPD patient. They're at their baseline. There's no need for investigation of that patient preoperatively. But if they're not at baseline or they have unexplained dyspnea or exercise intolerance, those you have to investigate. So what investigations are we going to do? We're going to consider two tests. And as I said, in part two, we're going to look at these beautiful risk calculators. So there's your two tests, spirometry and a chest X-ray. Now, spirometry is really an excellent diagnostic tool. Make a diagnosis of many lung conditions. It's also very useful in monitoring therapy. The patient's being diagnosed, they're on therapy. We want to look at the success of that therapy. Do we need to change therapy so we can just follow them up? But it's not really a good predictor of postoperative outcome. There is some sparse evidence to suggest if there's an FEV1 of less than 61%, that there might be an increased risk, but the evidence is really not that good. Chest X-ray, it's just a knee-jerk reaction to order chest X-ray preoperatively, especially above a certain age. Many units have that, and certainly if that is what your unit does, please stick with that. But there's some research that looked into this, taking a whole bunch of patients who's had chest X-rays, and it only actually shows that only 3% of these people who had preoperative chest X-rays will actually have their management altered. 97% were just going to go straight to theater after all these tests and have their anesthetic. So it doesn't really lead to change in management. And there's also some research to show that if you just compare patients who've had a chest x-ray versus those that don't, there's no difference in outcome between these two. So it's not that it really improves your patient's outcome. But it is on the tick list at most units after a certain age or under certain circumstances to get a chest x-ray. And stick with that. Just understand what the evidence for that is. Now, this is part one. And part two, we're going to start looking at one specific condition that we don't always think about, and that is obstructive sleep apnea syndrome.